Song structure. It is absolutely one of the most important factors in writing a great song, but it is often overlooked and underappreciated. When you learn about the most common segments of a song, the puzzle pieces, so to speak, as well as how best to fit them together to provide an exciting and compelling experience for your listeners, then you are one giant leap closer to greatness as a songwriter. And in this video series, I'm going to teach you everything I know personally about song structure so you can make that leap forward with your songwriting for yourself. Greetings, my friend. My name is Ethan, aka The Ghost Mall. I write and produce synth pop and soundtrack style music inspired by the 1980s and the early 1990s, a genre also called retrowave. And while I welcome all my fellow retro fanatics, synth lovers, and nostalgia fiends to this course on song structure, I also want to say up front that these lessons apply 100% to whatever genre of music you may adore and write yourself. I personally have produced everything from alt-rock to hip-hop, folk to reggae, country to R&B and back again, and I have found that certain foundational principles of songwriting apply regardless of style or subgenre. Basic laws of human psychology are at work when it comes to writing songs that really impact people's emotions and stick with them. And that goes for all people, and therefore, all kinds of music. And while there are definitely other core elements to a great song, particularly a memorable melody, impactful lyrics with a unique perspective, and inventive and appropriate chord progressions, just to name a few, the structure of your song goes a long way toward its success or failure in reaching your audience's hearts. So let's jump right in with part one of Song Structure 101, where, over the course of three short videos, I will specifically detail for you the most common sections we find in all songs, as well as some less common or optional ones. I'll tell you their functions so you know why and when we use them. I'll also explain how those puzzle pieces are typically fitted together, and perhaps more importantly, why fitting them together in common ways makes sense to our ears, our brains, and our hearts. Finally, I'll also offer you three ready-made formulas, one per video, from very simple on the one hand to quite complex on the other, for you to try out in your own songs. And that's just in part one. In part two, I'm going to break down a half dozen classic example songs, all from the 1980s, since that is my main wellspring of inspiration, so you can see how truly great songs piece these things together, and also how they sometimes bend or break rules to great effect. And for contrast, and to provide even more terrific examples, in part three, I'll do the same kind of detailed breakdown for a half dozen modern hits from the last 2 or 3 years. But we'll cross that bridge when we get to those parts of the course. Okay, sorry for the musical pun. Let's get started. Oh, and very quickly, I want to give a special thank you shout out to subscriber Julian Solo for suggesting this series topic. I appreciate you urging me to make this, and I hope you'll like it. Let's start with the two or three most essential, indispensable song sections. Most songs have all three of these, and it is totally possible to write a great song with nothing but these three sections. It is even possible to write a simple but viable song with only the first one or two. So what are they? First, the verse. This will often be the very first thing your listener hears, or at least their first taste of the lyrics and vocal melody in your song. So how do we know a verse when we hear it, and what is its purpose? Well, verses within a given song will usually have an identical, or at least a very similar melody. While on the other hand, 95% of the time, those verses will have different lyrics from one another. This is really a function of the verse's role within the song, which is to set up and advance the song's story or theme. In this regard, verses are very similar to stanzas in poetry. Each verse relates an event in the song's storyline, if it's a narrative song. Take, for example, "Movin' Out" by Billy Joel. Or it relates some perspective on or facet of the song's theme, if it's a more thematic and less narrative tune. Take the opening lines of Katy Perry's "Firework," for example. This is done one verse at a time until everything that needs to be said is said. Now, in some very traditional forms of songwriting, such as in Celtic folk songs or Appalachian folk songs, which are partially derived from Celtic music, a song might literally be composed of nothing but verse after verse, even upwards of a dozen verses sometimes. This was in part because those folk songs may literally have been stanza-based poems set to music, or simply new songs based on that poetic format. Now, it's quite rare to hear songs in a modern context composed solely of verses, but traditional folk songs do illustrate the point that a verse-only song structure is possible, viable, and perhaps even desirable depending on what you want to achieve with your song. With that said, in the context of modern music that we might hear on the radio, and by modern, I mean from the last 75 years or so, verses are not going to be the only section of the song, and they typically occur only 2 to 3 times within an average song. And when I get to the slides with the 3 structure formulas that I have for you in this series, you'll be able to see when verses usually appear and how they connect to the other sections. As for length, 8 or 16 bars are the most common formats for verses, but variations, sometimes even including an odd number of bars for a special effect, is not uncommon. The second most important segment in a song, or perhaps the first most important, depending on how you look at it, is the chorus. For the sake of clarity and your ability to discuss this with other songwriters, you should know that the chorus is also sometimes called the hook, although that can be confusing, since hook may also refer to any catchy element in a song. Or, and this is less common these days, a chorus can also be referred to as a refrain. But regardless of what we call it, this is the section which is usually repeated the most, hence refrain. It's the catchiest or most memorable, hence hook. And it's the part most likely to get people singing along, hence chorus. Basically, in my opinion, the chorus is the heart of any song. Because the chorus is inherently destined for repetition, the choruses within a given song almost always share an identical melody. Now, that doesn't mean that a vocalist or a lead instrumentalist won't sometimes add little variations or ornaments to later choruses for interest's sake, but they won't ever stray too far from the chorus's established melody, at least not in a song that's going to be satisfying to the listener. In addition to sharing a melody, choruses also share the same lyrics 95% of the time. And if you're keeping track, this is exactly the opposite of the verse. As for the chorus's function in the song, in essence, it either encapsulates the song's theme, perhaps something like love, friendship, revenge, desire, etc. And as you can see, these can often be related in one word as an emotion. In fact, I believe the aptly named Sad by XXXTentacion does this quite well. Or, alternatively, the chorus describes the conclusion of the story that the song tells, such as in A-ha's classic Take On Me, when singer Morton Harkett promises, "I'll be gone in a day or two." Or, the chorus may do both of these things, encapsulate the theme and conclude the story. The chorus is usually repeated 3 or 4 times, once following each verse, and also very often doubled up at the end of the song. It is also fairly common to begin a song with a chorus, and that would increase how many times it appears in the song. The length of the average chorus, like the verse, usually follows multiples of 8 bars, but can similarly vary. One thing to be aware of when listening to other songs and writing your own is the relative length of verses versus choruses. Often a chorus may be half the length of a verse, but sometimes the opposite is true if the chorus is particularly complex or if the songwriter simply wants to devote more time to the hook of the song. The third and final basic song segment that we'll cover is the bridge. It is also sometimes called the middle 8, meaning 8 bars that appear in the middle of the song, although that's somewhat incorrect, as I'll explain in a second. It is also rarely referred to as the breakdown, though that can also be misleading, since breakdown also describes any section of a song in which instrumentation is stripped away, or the beat becomes the focus instead of other instruments. So bridge is probably the most preferable term. Instead of truly falling in the middle of a song, the bridge almost always can be found about 2/3 of the way through. If I were to open up SoundCloud, YouTube, or Spotify, and choose a song and then use the navigation slider to go to about 2/3 of the way through, I can almost guarantee that would fall within the bridge. And the reason why has to do with one of its functions. The bridge provides, first, a break from the alternating verse-chorus-verse-chorus dynamic that has prevailed up to that point. Usually will allow 2 verses and 2 choruses before providing a break with the bridge, and that puts us roughly 2/3 of the way through a typical song structure. The second important thing that a bridge provides is some kind of dynamic shift, either up or down. By dynamic, I mean a change in the overall loudness, intensity, and/or complexity of the performance and arrangement. Of course, this can go two directions. You can either depart from the already big chorus by bringing things back down, something I call a dynamic reset, a term I borrowed from the Smashing Pumpkins' Billy Corgan, or you can instead try to one-up the power of the chorus by building up even further in the bridge. Very often a bridge will do both, by having two separate sections, one build and one breakdown. And actually, the Smashing Pumpkins' Bullet with Butterfly Wings is a great example of this. To provide further contrast with the verses and the choruses, a bridge will frequently, but not always, provide a new melody and or chord progression which hasn't been heard so far in the song. Now, it bears mentioning that the contents of bridges are the most diverse of all the segments of song structure. A bridge might include a new vocal section, a new instrumental section, an instrumental solo, a third verse, just to name a few possibilities. It might also interpolate motifs or elements from the song's verses or choruses in new ways. You can hear examples of this in some of Max Martin's early hits like Oops, I Did It Again or Tearing Up My Heart, where he interpolates chorus lyrics set to a new melody during the bridge. Basically, I like to think of the bridge as an opportunity to get inventive and creative and really provide something new for the listener, while at the same time, of course, continuing to move the theme or story of the song along. So, what would a basic song structure formula that incorporates these three essential sections look like? Well, I put one together for you, and truly, this is perhaps the most common song structure of all, and it has been throughout decades of contemporary music. It's simple, but extremely effective, and it goes: verse, chorus, second verse, chorus, bridge, and the chorus two times doubled up at the end. The natural and solid flow of this structure is pretty undeniable. We begin straight away with a verse, providing some context for the story, followed by the first chorus, condensing the theme. The second verse follows immediately, advancing the story even further, and is again punctuated by a chorus. The bridge may further advance the story events to their culmination, if it's a vocal section, or it might provide another emotional moment with a solo, etc. And the main point of the song is reinforced by doubling up the chorus at the end. You could truly build a successful songwriting career based just on this formula, so please feel free to start here, take this for yourself, and run with it. But if you're interested in adding some more variation and possibilities to the flow of your songs, then please stay tuned for the next video, where I'll teach you all about transition sections and their place in song structure. To make sure you're notified when the video is posted, please click subscribe. And if you got value from this first part of the series, please feel free to click the thumbs up icon to add it to your liked videos. Thanks for watching, fellow songwriter, and I'll see you soon in the next segment.